Hiking the Highline Trail is surely on any avid hiker's bucket list when visiting Glacier National Park. This rigorous trek will take visitors from Logan's Pass, along the Garden Wall, and up to Grinnell Glacier Overlook, all before reaching the Granite Park Chalet. From the Granite Park Chalet, hikers can either double back on the path they came, covering the Continental Divide in the opposite direction, or continue on towards the Loop, where the National Park Shuttle System can return you to your vehicle. Well regarded as one of the most spectacular hikes in the United States National Park System, hiking the Highline Trail isn't for the faint of heart. The Highline Trail has been popularized by its iconic handrail section near the trailhead. At times, the trail is no more than 3 feet or 1 meter wide and winds high above going to the Sun Road. In this video, I'm going to cover everything you should know before attempting this bucket list worthy adventure in the place known as the Crown of the Continent. And along the way, I'll be sharing with you footage I shot during the day that we hiked. So let's get started. First, let's cover where the Highline Trail is located. The Highline Trail's starting point originates from the Logan's Pass Visitor Center in Glacier National Park. Glacier National Park is located in northern Montana near the border with Canada. If you're staying in the town of Whitefish, which sits to the west, it can take over 90 minutes to reach Logan's Pass, while it takes about 1 hour to get there from Many Glacier, which sits to the east. Once you've reached Logan's Pass and secured parking, you'll find the trailhead located just across going to the Sun Road. Now that you know where the Highline Trail is located, let's discuss the length, elevation gain, and duration of the hike. First, keep in mind that there are a few different ways to complete this hike, and some visitors may elect to skip the Grinnell Glacier Overlook Spur altogether. The route I cover in this video involves beginning at Logan's Pass, hiking up to the Grinnell Overlook, past the Granite Park Chalet, and finishing down at the Loop parking lot. This option is about 14 miles long, or 22 kilometers in length. It has about 2,600 feet of elevation gain, which is about 800 meters. It will take most visitors 7 to 8 hours to complete, including some stops along the way. You can shave about 2 miles and 1,000 feet of elevation gain off of the hike if you decide to skip the rigorous Grinnell Overlook Spur, but if you're going to come all this way, I'd suggest just completing this leg of the hike. Another option is that once you reach the Granite Park Chalet, you can turn around and hike back to Logan's Pass to complete the hike as an out and back instead of a point-to-point route. This option is slightly longer, has more elevation gain, and requires you to pass a lot of other hikers on the narrow trail back to Logan's Pass. The views are better with this option, but you have already seen all of them on your way out to the chalet in the first place. I'd really only recommend this option if for some reason the park shuttle isn't running or you foresee other issues getting back from the Loop parking lot back to your car at Logan's Pass. Next, let's discuss the width of the Highline Trail. Many sections of the Highline Trail are no wider than 3 or 4 feet or about 1 meter. The earliest section of trail does have handrails for hikers to hold on to, but be warned that there are other narrow sections further along that won't offer you this additional layer of safety. Not only is the trail narrow, but many portions have a steep cliff drop to one side, which can make the trail feel a little bit more narrow than it actually is. Just be sure to be extra careful around any wet or slick portions of the trail when passing other hikers or wildlife along the way. Don't be fooled into thinking that the handrail section at the beginning is the only narrow section. There's quite a bit of narrow trail along this hike, which brings us to a very important question. Should you hike the Highline Trail if you have a fear of heights? And I would say the Highline Trail is not suitable for people who are susceptible to vertigo or have a legitimate fear of heights. If you're unsure of whether or not you should attempt this trek during your visit to Glacier National Park, here's how I'd advise gauging your ability. Plan a different hike from Logan's Pass, such as Hidden Lake, for your first day in the park. Secure your parking spot at Logan's Pass, and then instead of doing that hike, go across the street and head down to the start of the Highline Trail. The handrail section is very close to the beginning of the trail, so you can quickly get a feel for how narrow the path will be and how steep the drops are. If you can work this portion comfortably, then you should be able to complete the full hike without getting into any trouble. Come back another day during your visit with the proper gear and supplies and enjoy this day trek to its fullest. Personally, I knew this hike was bumping up against my own comfort levels with heights and vertical drops, but the good news is that by the end of the Highline Trail, I felt like I had gained a significant level of comfort hiking along this type of terrain. Now let's cover the best time of year to attempt the Highline Trail. The ideal window for hiking the Highline Trail is relatively short each year. To access the trailhead, you'll need to reach Logan's Pass via Going to the Sun Road. Going to the Sun Road usually opens each year by mid-July, but the exact timing can vary as it is subject to weather conditions in the park. Even if you're able to access the trailhead in early July, you run the risk of snow and ice still being present on the trail. This can present issues for hikers as much of the trail is very narrow and exposed to steep drops. To give yourself the best chance of hiking the Highland Trail, I'd recommend timing your visit to Glacier National Park for late July or early August. September is usually another good month for hiking in the park as the crowds have started to thin out. However, the weather also starts to turn this time of year, and it's not uncommon for wildfire activity here or in other parks in the United States to create hazy conditions during late August or early September. When attempting hikes like this, it's always advisable to check trail conditions and for any closures directly with the National Park Service. I'll be sure to leave a link to where you can do that in the video description below. And now let's discuss the best time of day to attempt the Highline Trail. There are several reasons why you'll want to arrive extremely early in the morning when attempting the Highline Trail. The first is that the parking lot at Logan's Pass can fill up very early in the morning. During the busy season, it's not uncommon for this area to fill up by 7 a.m. Since many of the hikes originating from this area are lengthy, and that means the parking spots might not start to turn over for a couple of hours. If you fail to secure a spot, you'll either have to park down the road, adding length to this already long trek, or you'll have to sit and camp out for a spot, and neither of those are a good outcome. The second reason to arrive super early is to avoid sun exposure in midday heat as much as possible. When we did this hike in early August, the highs were in the mid 80s and it was extremely hot. The earlier you start, the better your chances of finishing without spending too much time in the midday heat. Despite this trail's difficulty, it is still an extremely popular hike in Glacier National Park. An early start means you'll avoid hiking during the busiest part of the day. This means less congestion along the very narrow trail. If you're finishing up at the loop, you'll also need to make it to the end before the shuttle service stops running for the day. The next important thing to know about this hike is that there are really only two bathroom options along the way. The first of those options are at Logan's Pass Visitor Center, which I'd recommend taking advantage of before you start out on the trail. After that, the only other option is at Granite Park Chalet, which is about 6 to 8 miles into your journey, depending on whether or not you hike to the overlook. Given the narrow trail and lack of tree cover, there aren't really many great options to go outside of the formal bathrooms if you find yourself in a pinch. The next thing I want to cover in this video is the Grinnell Overlook Spur. You'll reach the Overlook Spur not long before you reach the Granite Park Chalet. This portion of the hike is extremely rigorous. You'll ascend nearly 1,000 feet or about 300 meters in less than a mile. If you choose to skip the overlook, it will significantly reduce the difficulty of your Highline Trail experience, but for me, if you've come all this way, you gotta try it. The trail leading up to the overlook eventually becomes very steep and very narrow. Near the top, the trail starts to fade a bit, and I wouldn't quite call it scrambling, but you do need to be a bit more careful navigating the terrain up there. But if you can endure, the views from the overlook are incredible, and you'll even be able to spot the Grinnell Glacier, which resides just below. When we hiked there, it was a very busy and very windy afternoon. I generally do okay-ish with heights, but a lot of the viewing area sits in a saddle along the mountain ridge, and it was extremely windy on that day. I'm talking like 40 or 50 mile an hour wind gusts. It was also pretty crowded by the time we reached the overlook. Even though we started early in the morning, so did a lot of other hikers. We weren't the fastest people on the trail, so even more people caught up to us by the time we reached the overlook. So be prepared to deal with crowds, actually, once you're up on the viewing area. And from what I've heard from many others, the second tier to the overlook offers even better views than the first, but it's also a little bit further up the ridgeline. And again, on this day, it was way too crowded, way too windy. I was already kind of pushing myself a bit dealing with the heights, so we ended up just skipping that part of the overlook and heading back down. Next, we're gonna cover if you need a reservation or permit to hike the Highline Trail. And the answer is no. You don't need a permit, you don't have to win a lottery like with certain overcrowded hikes in the national park system, but don't forget that you do need a Going to the Sun Road timed entry reservation during peak season to reach Logan's Pass where the trailhead originates. If you haven't used this system when visiting a national park, I'd recommend reading my guide on the timed entry reservation system beforehand. These reservations tend to sell out immediately once they become available from the National Park Service. The worst thing you could do is plan this amazing trip to Glacier National Park and then fail to secure timed entry reservation and not even be able to get into the park. I'll include a link to that full length guide in the description below. It even includes some tips and tricks for what to do if you find yourself without a reservation at the last minute. Next up, let's cover cellular service along the Highline Trail. And the short answer is no, you won't have any cell service while hiking the Highline Trail. Cellular service throughout Glacier National Park is very hard to come by. Like many other hikes in the park, the Highline Trail will span very remote portions of the park with little to no cellular coverage, which means be sure to download any offline offline maps you might want before you enter the park. If you don't use it already, All Trails Pro is a great resource for this and will ensure you stay on the right trail and help you keep track of your distance when doing activities like this. The good news, if you don't have that for the Highline Trail, the path is pretty straightforward and difficult to lose track of, so it would be hard to get lost or turned around on this hike. Now, let's discuss a few packing tips for the Highline Trail. Given the duration of this hike, it's important to pack plenty of water and salty snacks to ensure you stay hydrated. During our hike, I drank down my entire 3-liter reservoir and an extra bottle of water I purchased at the Granite Park Chalet. You can purchase light snacks and water at the Granite Park Chalet, but I'd still suggest packing out more than enough food and water to get you through this hike, and use a chalet as more of a backup to top off when you get there. The hike is almost entirely exposed, so even during the hotter months, you may want to consider hiking with a super light, moisture-wicking long sleeve and pants to cut down on sun exposure. Either way, be sure to pack plenty of sunscreen. Bugs weren't an issue for us, but I've heard they can be worse during certain parts of the year, and when you're descending down past the Granite Park Chalet towards the loop. So consider packing bug spray as well. Be sure to pack hiking boots with great traction that are already broken in, since you're going to be hiking 14 miles and along some very narrow trail. This is not a great time to break in a new pair of hiking boots. Trekking poles are also a very nice thing to have on this hike, specifically for the overlook spur and the descent towards the loop, which can be a pretty steady and steep decline. Those will go a long way towards saving your knees during steep descents and helping you with the steep climb up to the Grinnell Overlook. And perhaps the most important thing to pack on this hike is bear spray. We did encounter an adolescent grizzly bear during our descent towards the loop after the Granite Park Chalet that was sitting directly on the hiking trail. Luckily, once we spotted it, we were able to spook it off by making some noise and didn't have to use our spray. But we did come very close to having to use it on this occasion and another occasion when hiking back from Iceberg Lake in Many Glacier. I cannot emphasize enough, do not hike in Glacier National Park without bear spray. If you're interested in a more thorough day hike packing list, I put together a comprehensive guide that's available on my blog. It's the perfect thing to look over when preparing for a full day hiking adventure like the Highline Trail to ensure that you don't leave anything else behind. Things like a first aid kit, extra socks, salt tablets, and more. So be sure to check that out as well. I'll leave a link for it in the video description below. Hopefully you find this guide covering the Highline Trail helpful as you prepare for your trip to Glacier National Park. Feel free to reach out on social media or drop a comment below if you have any specific questions that went unanswered in this video. Don't forget to check out some of my other Glacier National Park guides that are available on my blog. I've included links to those in the description as well for your convenience. If you enjoyed this video, don't forget to like and subscribe so you don't miss out on any other future travel guides that I publish to this channel. I'm Wes Murgard with WorkRemotelyLiveRemotely.com, and thanks for watching.